this really is the galactic concentrator. Okay, if you hold that in the right spot, it will take the power that comes from the black hole at the center of the galaxy and you focus upon you, and it gives you eternal beauty and intelligence and all the good stuff. But don't tell that to anybody else. Hi, we're going to talk about the topology of twisted toroids. Now that sounds a little frightening, does it?
It does.
But so let's keep it simple. I'm Carlos Sacan, and this is a bagel. And if you're familiar with bagels, you know you don't just eat the bagel dry. What you do is you basically slice it, right? You kind of cut it open, and then you put green cheese on it. For a mathematician, this is a torus. Anything that has a smooth shape is just one hole, that's called a torus. If you're a mathematician, you can smoothly deform that into any other shape. So interestingly enough, if you take your coffee cup with a handle like that, and even though it has this big void and all of that, topologically, it is still a torus. So to mathematicians, you know, shape is not important. It's just a connectivity and something that has one tunnel here or one handle. That essentially is a genus one surface, and they call that a torus. Now, if we cut this bagel, what do we get? We're basically getting two tori. Each one individually, even though the shape is different, you know, still has essentially one ring, one handle, and one hole through it, so it's still a torus. But now, what if we're kind of crazy, and rather than slicing this as one nice plane, we essentially start stabbing through the torus like that, and then as we go around the perimeter, we rotate our knife around. Okay. And if I'm doing that very carefully and kind of cutting through, and I'm rotating my knife all the way around, and then doing it on the other side, the donut will still fall apart into two individual pieces.
Is that two pieces, Professor?
It's two separate pieces, but they're now linked. Individually, both of them are still tori. They're still essentially rings with one handle, but now I can hold one and the other one will not fall on the floor, which is a great advantage if you're eating those on, you know, on the train and it's kind of shaking. And there's another benefit. If we compare that surface in here, compared to the surface we had before, this surface here is actually bigger. That means we can put more cream cheese into this bagel, and then we've put it back together. It'll make a much juicier bagel. To a topological-oriented mathematician, they're just two tori, because in topology, we're actually allowed of sliding surfaces through one another. Now, if you're a knot theoretician, and you're talking about knot and links, then this is different, because these two rings are linked, whereas the other two were not linked. You can separate them, move them apart. You cannot separate those two things. Now, this geometry is not my invention. This geometry is actually due to Keizo Ushio. He is a well-known stone sculptor in Japan, well-known over there, not so well-known in this particular country. I first met him in 1999. It was at a conference on art and mathematics in San Sebastian, Spain. And before the conference, he had carved a really large, about 3 foot diameter, granite torus in a perfect shape like that. And then during the conference, he was drilling a sequence of a couple of hundred holes in this spiral fashion through this granite donut, just like I have sliced through the bagel before. Now, in this case, we have a nice hole, and the diameter of that hole is just about the same diameter as the diameter of the worm. So now, when I take these two apart, they come apart much more nicely, and they rattle. And not only that, but I can put them into this configuration, which you can see is locking up very nicely. And he then rearranged those two rings, and then essentially left a sculpture there that looks something like that. Anyhow, I wanted to better understand that, because I saw it and I understood it, but I felt until I have one in my hand that I can manipulate, I really don't know. So I went home, and within 1 month, I made this object on our own fused deposition modeling machine, which is, you know, a very sturdy rapid prototyping machine. Built it a little bit apart so just it wouldn't touch, just so in this particular shape. And there's kind of a filler material that would be in the gap when you build it, but the filler material can easily be then scratched out, and you can wedge these things apart and then clean out the surface, all the filler material. So I get the really perfect replica of this object, and now I finally understand what is going on. So we have two of these interlinked. Could I somehow get three of them interlinked? And so I had to think about it for a while, but then it became obvious. Well, if you take a different kind of knife, not kind of, you know, a straight knife that we sort of rotate around the middle of the blade as we go around the torus, but instead we take a knife like that. So now we have essentially three sort of half blades coming together in the middle, and I slowly rotate that knife as I push it forward along the worm of the torus. And going once around the torus, I will make sure that this rotates exactly 360 degrees. It's kind of important to do it that way. And then we get this. And you can see those spiral cuts. And you don't quite know what to expect until you kind of shake it loose, right?
That's brilliant.
And now we can see we have three of those pieces all interlinked. Of course, we can do it with three blades. What about if you use four blades? We could put them at 90 degree and add a fourth one. It's the same as basically using two cuts with a knife, one going around that way, the other one going around that way. But in either case, we would still turn the whole contraption through a full 360 degrees. So every piece of material winds around the torus and connects back to itself. Well, what would you get? Probably something that has four rings. And in order to make it more visible, I gave this one not a round donut shaped cross-section, but I basically made a square cross-section. It's topolush, still a torus, just the fact that it has ridges and flat faces doesn't matter. And now, after the cut, you know, yes indeed, you get something that has four intertwined rings. You immediately ask it, what about five? What about six? Well, six is a nice one, because now we can start out with a hexagon cross-section, a perfectly regular hexagon. And if you cut a hexagon with, you know, three diameters, then each one of the pieces is itself a small triangle. And these triangles are perfectly equilateral, so you can see a perfectly equilateral cross-section. And then six of those essentially form the hexagon that makes this shape. And by cutting it apart, yeah, we of course get now six rings. And that makes an even more intriguing kind of potential sculptures that we might have, and that it makes an even harder puzzle. That's where I stopped. So now I try to build one of these, okay, what we've seen before, rotating the knife a full 360 degrees as we go around the donut. Well, if you do it wrong, and you rotate your knife only 180 degrees. And what does that do? Well, somehow this doesn't want to come apart here. Okay, if you look at that, then it still hangs together. It seems to be like one band. Actually, it's a band that goes around the loop twice and seems to be somewhat intertwined.
And is it one continuous piece of bread then?
It's one continuous piece of bread. So it's a little harder to, you know, cram the cream cheese in there. And again, we can look to some sculptures of Keisa Ushio, who has made this kind of shape, but much more beautiful and much more regular. I've exaggerated what he has done in some of his sculptures. And you can see it's basically a donut, and you get this one groove that spirals around that goes to the inside. Now, I really would like to make a really giant sculpture of this. It would be awesome to have a sculpture like that where you could step inside and see yourself reflected again and again in all the different parts of this inner space. So let's focus on that inner space. What have we taken away from the torus? We have cut something out, and that thing that we have cut out is actually a Möbius band.
Ah,
what's a Möbius band? Oh, let's see.
Oh.
If you take off your belt here, right, and you wrap your belt around, you know, that, in the ordinary way you close your belt, it's just a cylinder. But if we give that belt a 180 degree twist so the dull side gets to the shiny side and connect it in that way, now we have a Möbius band. And what's special about the Möbius band is that if you start hiking on the shiny side, and we go around, suddenly, whoops, we're ending up on the other side. So we have stepped from one side of the band to the other without going over the edge, but just going once around the loop. So that's a Möbius band. Of course, that's a very, very famous structure. But before, I already mentioned that we might want to rotate the knife at different rates. So what happens if you rotate it three times as fast? So as it goes around, it swings through three times 180 degrees. And you get this.
Wow.
But now we've taken out a Möbius space that makes three flips. I call it the triply twisted Möbius space. And I certainly sent pictures of that to Keizo Ushio and asked him whether he would carve one of those. And so far he hasn't done it yet, but I think one of these days he might come up and create a big stone sculpture that has this particular shape.
It looks like kind of like a propeller or something, the one on this side. It looks like it should be on the front of a plane or something.
Yeah, or it could be the head of a tunnel boring machine. Or, what you don't know, this really is the galactic concentrator. Okay, if you hold that in the right spot, it will take the power that comes from the black hole at the center of the galaxy and it focus upon you and it gives you eternal beauty and intelligence and all the good stuff. But don't tell that to anybody else. Yeah, you're not the first one that thinks I'm crazy. Now, you were asking, is this any good? And you know, some architects were fascinated by the concept of Möbius something. And so obviously is, can you build a Möbius house?